We are continuing our series called Christ Like. Say Christ Like. Let's see our Bibles, church. Let's see our Bibles. For those of you first time, we encourage everyone to bring their Bibles, because we believe if you don't have a Bible, you're not going to heaven. You're going straight to hell right now. Right now.
Yeah, please bring your Bible.
I'm just kidding. It's a message. We have Bibles, by the way. Only $5.
$10.
Let's see the Bible, church. Let's see the Bibles. Let's see the Bibles. This morning, let's throw our Bibles in the book of Philippians. And we are continuing our series here in the church called Christ-like. Say Christ-like. And in this series, we're talking about the ultimate goal for us believers of Christ. That's why we call ourselves Christians, or we are called Christians, is because we bear the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the ultimate goal for us as Christians, the Bible says that God knew His people and He called them to be conformed to the image of His Son, which is Jesus Christ. Our ultimate goal as a Christian, especially now with social media, we all want to get likes. But the ultimate goal as a Christian is not to get likes, but to be Christ-like.
Amen.
And so, in this series, we've been studying that last week we talked about being teachable. Actually, that's a very good reminder. Turn to the person next to you and ask that person, are you teachable? Is it easy for you to be instructed? Is it easy for you to take instructions? Or sometimes you get too defensive, or sometimes you get too sensitive when someone corrects you. The Bible says that it takes humility. If we want to be conformed in the image of Christ, that God will constantly work in our lives. God will constantly work in our hearts. And there are people that is going to be around us that God will use to conform us to the image of His Son. I know all of us here have some kind of people that we look up to, celebrities, sports figure, athletes, and all that. And we look up to them because they do something that's very special. And we admire that. And we say, oh God, I wish I could be like that. As believers of Christ, let's not forget our goal is to be like Christ. It's not to be like Jesus. It's not to be Jesus, because Jesus is God, but to be more like Him. And our prayer is, God, work in my heart. Work in my heart. Because in this world, there's so many things that the world is teaching us today, that you can change your appearance, you can lose weight, you can whiten your teeth, you can, you know, dress this way and all that. And you've seen you have a whole makeover, an extreme makeover, and you totally look different. But the question about your heart. About your heart. Are you allowing God to change your heart and to conform into the heart of Christ? And today what we're going to talk about is the attitude of Jesus Christ. And so we titled this message this morning, Watch Your Attitude. Turn the person next to you and say, watch your attitude. Oh snap, that's when you started. It's going to go on. Oh no. We all have attitudes. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Now the question is our attitude becoming more like Jesus, or our attitude, we're just settling with, this is who I am. That's not what God called us to be. And let's all bow our heads and let's pray together as we open up this sermon this morning. Father God, we pray and ask, Lord, that you give us the humility in our hearts this morning to receive your word. Lord, make us teachable. Allow us to be teachable, Lord God. Allow us to be like a clay. You are the potter. You are molding us to be more like you, Lord. Lord, we are bowing down in humility this morning and asking, Lord, that you tear down any pride in our lives. The pride, Lord, the ego that sometimes does not want to listen. The pride in our heart that we think that we're always right, that we always have to be right. Lord, may you tear it down this morning, Lord God, and just allow us to receive your word, that we will be able, Lord God, to truly apply it in our lives. Lord, this is our prayer this morning. As we pray, we ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone says,
amen.
One of the curious movies I've seen
pretty much my entire life is the movie of Brad Pitt called The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. How many of you heard that movie? That is a peculiar movie because pretty much the main character was born old and grow old becoming young. Are you guys following me? So it's the complete opposite. So he was born looking like 80 years old, and as the longer he grows old, he becomes like 15, 16, and when he died, he was a baby. And so it's the complete opposite. And many times in our thinking, of course, when we are growing older, the right way of doing things is we become more mature. Can you hear that? But in this movie, it's the complete opposite. And how many times is it that many times in our walk with God, that the more we walk with Him, God wants us to mature in our walk with Him. But sometimes Christians, we have that Benjamin Button syndrome. That the more we walk with God, sometimes it feels like it's the complete opposite that is happening. That our attitude, instead of being conformed to the image of Christ, is becoming more conformed to the image of this world. That's why many still are confused and say, is that really what Christians are like? Because I really don't see the difference. And so the question that challenges us this morning is, what is the ultimate measure of our walk with God? How can we measure if we are truly growing with our walk with God? Don't you want to measure if you are growing in your career? Don't you want to measure if you are progressing in your life? Don't you want to measure? I mean, anywhere you go, there's always measurements of, you know, what you have accomplished and all these things. What, you know, that's why we finish degrees. If you go to school, you know, you pass exams because it shows the progression. But how about our Christian life? How can we ask ourselves, and God, am I growing? Am I being more conformed in the image of your Son, Jesus? And one of, I think, of course, there are many multiple answers to this question, but I think one of the measure of that is our attitude. Say attitude. Turn to the person next to you, say attitude. You know, in psychology, an attitude is described as a psychological construct. It is a mental and emotional, say mental, say emotional, entity that inheres in or characterizes a person. In other words, it is what your mindset is towards person, toward things, toward events, toward space, towards whatever it is. It is your mindset that conducts your attitude. And so the question for us this morning is simple as this. Our attitude shows how much work the Holy Spirit has done so far in our walk with God. And so the question is, how is our attitude? How is our attitude? God, how is my attitude? When I come to you, when I look at myself in the mirror, when I reflect on how I treat people, when I reflect on how I treat family, when I reflect on how I treat friends, when I reflect how I treat my marriage, when I reflect how I treat other people, workplace, wherever I'm at, my attitude shows. And it's something that I cannot, maybe I could try to cover it up every now and then, but when I come to you, God, you see it. And so this morning, church, here is our question. God, how is my attitude? Has my attitude changed since I started walking with you? Has my attitude changed since I become a Christian? And what attitude that still need changing in my life right now? Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Here's what I always I believe. I can fool you on how I act, but I can never fool myself, and I can never fool God. Yes.
That's right. Amen. Only you and us know who we really are. Only us know how our attitude really is like. Can I hear an amen? You can use all these filters, the flowers, the things on Facebook and Instagram and make it look good. Can I hear an amen? You know, you can turn your face into a monkey or a bear or whatever, or a rat or whatever. Right? You can do all these filters. But when you get to you and your God, only you, Him, knows who we really are. Can I hear an amen? And the challenge for us this morning is, God, I know I cannot change it myself. I tried. I know I cannot change it myself. What I need is to allow you to continue to work in my life. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Sometimes we feel like God changed my attitude and God is just going to send a FedEx box, show up at our home, and here, and it says, attitude change kit. Sometimes we think that God is just going to pull out something and say, oh, here's your attitude change kit. As long as you follow steps 1 to 10, your attitude will change. No. God will work in our heart. God will put us in situations where will call us to be humble. God will sometimes attack and destroy our pride. And if we are not teachable, if we are not sensitive to what God is doing, we keep saying and we keep making excuses that, well, this is who I am, God. I don't think this is how you made me. No, God says, no, I want to change you. That is the whole purpose of it. That's why we came to Christ. Not just so we can be saved and look at other people and say, hey, look at me, I'm going to heaven, I'm all good. No, God says, no, there is purpose. And one of the things that God will continue to change is our attitude. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
And how many of us can say amen to this? Sometimes our attitude is the hardest thing to change.
Amen.
Amen.
Because it consists of experiences, it consists of things that happened in the past, that happened in the present. It consists of all these presuppositions that we have in our mind. It consists of how we grew up. It consists of the people that's around us. It consists of a lot of things. And here's the message that I want to give all of us here tonight. Here's God's message telling us, it's okay, you can put that all aside now. All you have to do now is to focus on who Jesus is in your life. But God, you know, I grew up in an abusive home. But God, you know what happened to me when I was a kid. But God, you know, I never had really that father's love. But God, you know, and God says, I understand. There's so many things that just hurt you. But you can put that aside now. Because I know your Lord and Savior. You can put that aside now, and I'm here to restore, and I'm here to heal, and I'm here to change, and I'm here to transform. The attitude that you need to look forward to now is not the things that you learned in the past, but the things that are now in front of you, that you fix your eyes on Jesus Christ alone. Can I hear that, man? Can we give a hand to our God this morning? Let's take a look at the scripture this morning. Let's turn our Bibles in the book of Philippians. In the book of Philippians chapter 2. And here the Apostle Paul, of course, talking to the church in Philippi. Encouraging them to live a life that is worthy of that calling to be a Christian. And Paul was very proud of what God has been doing in the church of Philippi. And here in verse 1 to 5, the story of Bible is Philippians chapter 2, verse 1 to 5. Follow along with me. It says here, is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from His love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Turn to the person next to you and say, are your heart tender and compassionate? Are your heart tender and compassionate? Or we need to put it in the broiler. We need to smoke it or snow cook it or whatever we need to do to make it tender.
church. He's saying, we are now one with Christ. We are now together with Christ. So, is there any encouragement from that? Is there anything that you're learning from that? Is your love actually changed? Is it now more, are you more now compassionate and tender-hearted? And then in verse 2 it says, then make me truly happy by what? Agreeing wholeheartedly with each other. You understand, this is the Paul, the spiritual father to the Philippian church. And he's pretty much telling them, you see me preach you the good news, you see me bring you who Christ is. I work and I labor, and I want to make sure that you understand who Christ is. So the only joy that I can get from it is it working? Is it really speaking to your heart? Are you really able to capture what you are being taught? Are you really embracing the message that I'm giving you? And so make my joy make me truly happy by what? First, it will see with your attitude. Can I hear an amen? If the Word of God, there's really a true conviction in our heart, if the Word of God is really spoken, and the people that are listening to it is actually receiving that Word with joy and with much conviction and compassion, then there is going to be fruit. And the fruit will be only seen on what? On our attitude. Can you hear me, man? You know, there's so many fitness plans going on right now on TV and all this. But the only proof that it works is when it started to show. It's the same approach as the Apostle Paul is saying here. If there is any encouragement from Christ, if there's any thing that you gain from being belonging to Christ, then make my joy complete by showing it in your attitude. And what is that attitude to begin with? Look what it says here. Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other. What else? Loving one another and working together with one mind and purpose. As believers of Christ, we are united by one Spirit, one Lord. Not divided. The Bible says that the church is like a body. Many parts, but just one body. You cannot go to work and your brain says, oh, I'm just gonna lay back today. Although sometimes it happens, right? You go to work, you're like, your brain is really not there. Probably left at home or something. No, it has to work together in unity. And not only that, again, talking about attitude, what is the attitude that Paul is expecting the Philippian church to have? Verse 3, look what it says here. Don't be
selfish.
Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be
humble,
thinking of others as better than yourselves. Wait a minute, Pastor. You know, I watch the TV, I watch the news. Everything says there, I have to be better than the person next to me. It's a competition. It's a dog-eat-dog world. I have to be better, so I conquer, so I have to be better to dominate. Isn't that the same conversation the disciples of Christ had after they had the Last Supper? They asked Jesus, can you allow me to sit right next to you in your right hand? And they're arguing to one another, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God? And Jesus told them, if you want to be the greatest, you have to be the least. If you want to be on top, you have to be at the bottom. The attitude of a Christian now tells us that there is a different paradigm in our attitude. Should be. And what is that? First, is that selfishness has to decrease. Can I hear an amen? How many times during the day that we are selfish? And I ask that many times, God, how many times during the day that I am selfish? That I always think about what I want, what is good to me, what is this and what is that? But the Bible keeps reminding us, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. and just gain the approval of men. Be humble in your thinking of others as better than yourselves. It's okay to think and it's okay to understand that there are people that are better than us. You know what kills jealousy in general? The Bible says, be happy with those who are happy and mourn with those who mourn. If you struggle so much with comparing yourself to other people, if you struggle so much with, oh, I come like this, I come not like this, apply that verse. I just want to be happy with who's happy and mourn with those who mourn. In other words, I didn't get paid, you got paid. Hey, I'm happy for you. No, that's just a pat on the back. Hey, you know, we dance the same, but they picked this guy. Oh, hey, I'm happy for you. And it's genuine, okay? It's not like coming out of your nose. Are you with me? The Bible says the attitude of a Christian now, our selfishness has to start to decrease as Christ starts to increase. Don't look out only for your own interest, but take an interest in others too. How many of you ever work in a team? How many of you ever part of a team? How many of you go to work and you are part of a team? And you go to church, we are a team. You know, the best way for a team to work is what? Team work. How does team work goes? What can you put in? What can I put in? How can we work together for one purpose and one goal? You know what that means?